We're back with you once again on WeConnect. And of course, as we were talking earlier, we're still right here with writer-activist Sivasankari. There's more to Sivasankari than writing. I know that you're trained Bharatanatyam dancer, trained classical musician. So where does all of this fit into your very busy schedule now that you finished with the 16-year project?
No, music and dance, they were all part of my life ever since I remembered. The family, it thrived on music. Everybody, my mother's side is of great heritage. And my mother's great uncle was the great Muthiah Bhagavathar, who is a great composer after the Trinities. So it runs in the family to enjoy music, to sing whenever it's possible, and dance.
But where have you had the time to do that?
Come on, you don't have to.
No, but 16 years, you've had your nose buried in these books and your research and your literature.
You know what, my dance, at least it stopped after my getting married. Before that, I've given public performances and I've done about 11 concerts in America and Canada too. But what happened, the thing is, in 1999, my teacher, Geja Sarasa, her school celebrated the Golden Jubilee. And she asked me, as one of her very important disciples, she said, "Will you dance?" I said, "Yes." And for 15 days, I went to the classes, I brushed up the whole thing, and I gave a concert for 1 hour in Nardgana Sabha, which was attended by G.K. Mupanar, Padma Subramaniam, and all, full packed crowd. Everybody thought Sivasankari, the writer, is going to make a fool of herself.
Right.
But I knew I won't, because dance was in my blood. I wanted to become a dancer, professional dancer. I couldn't do that. So that was picking up the dance after 40 years. But music, you don't need that kind of preparation. Once a week, say, you sit somewhere quietly for 1 hour and sing, or I ask my master to come whenever he's always ready to come. But I think hereafterwards I'll be more regular.
Right. So, of course, the loss, the dancing world probably lost the dancer, and the literary world found you.
Okay, thank you.
So now, I know that you lost your husband, and then you subsequently lost your mother very recently. Going forward, what do you see yourself? Can I ask, what's your next project? I mean, I know that you can't be keeping quiet. What are you up to now?
No, there are two different things. One is professional side, one is personal side. My personal side, soon after my mother's death, I had to decide certain things. Like, I was living in an independent house with my mother, with a battalion of servants and etc., etc., because lots of people used to come and go as headquarters.
Yes.
Then after my mother passing away, when she passed away, I realized that all of a sudden, I cannot depend on the servants also. They don't substitute family. So what family people plan as their future, I cannot be planning that. So I decided, in Hindu Dharma, they always say there are four stages: Brahmacharya, Grahastha, Vanaprastha and Sannyasa. Brahmacharya is your, bachelorhood. Grahastha is your family life. And Vanaprastha is where you prepare to give up everything happily. And now my Vanaprastha has started. So I've learned to give up one by one happily. If the decision is yours to give up, then you're happy. If it's forced on you, you're very unhappy. Right? Anything has to be voluntarily done. So now I've shifted to a flat. Now I'm trying to organize. I'm trying to become less dependent on people and servants. And my personal life, I just want to consolidate certain properties I have. And I want to go into charity in a very big way, because why should I wait until I die to do charity? I can start doing it in a big way while I'm alive, and I can see it and get the pleasure out of it. These are all in my personal side.
And professionally?
Professionally, see, the four volumes of Knit India Through Literature, they are so huge, they are like coffee table books, and they are expensive too. So now within a year's time, I'm going to bring 18 paperbacks, because 18 languages are covered in that. Instead of four volumes, I plan to bring 18 paperback books of each language. And then so many people have done so many translations of mine in English. I've just stacked them up and put them. So I have to take them out and read them and see what I can do.
Right. Some of your work was also translated into Ukrainian above yes. all. I just wanted to draw you
this
out.
This is your
that
drug problem.
Right.
That oven, the drug addiction story. I was, when the Furnika, the great Indologist of Soviet Russia, called me and talked to me and wrote to me, I was so surprised. You know what? At that time, Gorbachev was planning perestroika, the opening yes. up. So they wanted to prepare the nation well in advance against this drug addiction, which is a menace.
Yes.
So they wanted to, and how did they locate my book? I didn't know at all. They pinpointed on my book because somewhere in US consulate also they told me that as much as they knew, nobody has done drug addiction as a fiction like this before. So they said probably this is what must have interested them, and because it was in how did they read Tamil and
amazing.
How did they amazing, and it has gone to Ukrainian.
Right. Well, they think you were an amazing writer, and I salute you as being an absolutely amazing woman. I'm in complete admiration.
Oh,
that's
Jennifer.
All I can say. Thank you so much.
Jennifer, thank you so much. My admiration for you is also there, so it's mutual.
It's a joy to have had you on our show
thank
today.
You.
Thank you
it's
very much. Well, that's all we have time for on We Connect. We'd like to remind you that we're on this show every single week, and we do look forward to you joining us every single week. Take care. Bye for now.